Kriegstoff von Tübingen.
Was ist
Little town in the southwest of Germany.
And it has a very good university. And the famous people in Tübingen starting this chapter. And more recently, the title of Pope Benedict was also a professor of theology in Tübingen.
So, the title
of my section.
The question is to
can you hear me if I switch?
So, so I mean, the title was given by the organizers. When I saw the title, I was a little bit surprised because I'm not
going to talk about
climate observation theory or any quantum effective theories, but after thinking a while, I thought the title might be appropriate.
So, what I'm going to talk about is first about the
vacuum,
which I think is a complicated object. And I think we have not yet understood the basic feature of this vacuum from the first principle, which is the confinement in spontaneous breaking of chiral symmetry. We know that the quarks and gluons under normal conditions are confined inside hadrons, and the hadrons get most of their mass from spontaneous breaking of chiral symmetry. Then if we compress harmonic matter or heat it up, we know we have this phase transition to the quark gluon plasma, and this phase diagram has been shown several times during this meeting. So I don't have to tell much about this phase diagram. We have learned in Professor Tatschmeier's lecture that the lattice, this does not work, the pointer, we take this one. The lattice can describe this region basically, can go a little bit here in the finite temperature regime. We saw this Taylor expansion in terms of the chemical potential. But this is bound to chemical potentials of about twice the temperature, if I remember correctly the lecture from Professor Kutschmann.
Yes,
so in my talk, I will first talk about the vacuum properties of QCD, and then I will come to the confinement-based transition. Now, we have not yet a strict proof of confinement. And my battery somehow seems to expire. Do we have another one?
Yes, we can.
We have not yet a strict proof of confinement, but I encourage the young people here, if you work hard enough and you can eventually prove confinement, you can get this $1 million prize. Confinement problem is part of the million problems, which was put by the Clay Mathematical Institute.
There was a problem in mathematics which has already been solved
after a couple of years. After the new millennium has started, but I think the confinement problem will still be around for quite some time.
There is no 1 million for this.
Sorry.
There is no 1 million for the solution.
Yes, no one?
$1 million price.
Why not? You have to move confinement and mass gap and things like that, and then you get the 1 million, I think.
Really?
Yeah. Yeah, you have to solve this. Okay. Now, so we have not really a proof of confinement, but during the last 20 years, a couple of pictures, consistent pictures of the QCD vacuum and of the confinement mechanism has emerged. I would like to discuss these pictures during my lectures. Now, unfortunately, all these pictures are related to a certain gauge. So, I mean, these so-called magnetic monopole condensation picture or dual Meissner effect relies on the maximal ability gauge. Then there is the central vortex condensation picture. Then we have also a similar gauge, the maximum center gauge. And finally, there is this Griebov-Zwanziger mechanism, which relies on Coulomb gauge. So some people may argue confinement is a gauge-invariant phenomenon, so we should also have a gauge-invariant description. However, we should not be too ambitious. If I remember the lecture from John Paul this Monday, when he explained the Parton picture, he was emphasizing that even this Parton picture makes sense only in certain gauges, like the Lightwood gauge. So I mean, if even the Parton picture can be realized or is realized only in certain gauges, we should not be surprised that in the non-perturbative regime where we have confinement, we need also to fix the gauge in order that some picture emerges. So I mean, I'm fine with the fact that we need to fix the gauge in order to come to some picture of the QCD vacuum moment of confinement. Now, in my talk, I will discuss these three pictures, but before I start with these three pictures, I will made some phenomenological remarks on confinement, Calvin symmetry breaking, and in particular I will discuss here or summarize the various order parameters which we use in QCD because they will come again and again, and I will use it in the various pictures. So let me start with a few words about confinement. I mean, you all are familiar with confinement. You know that the hadrons are colorless states, also the quarks carry some color. And perhaps the simplest confined system is the heavy meson, and you have a heavy quark and a heavy anti-quark. Now, this system can be described in terms of potential models. And this model you can measure on the lattice, and what you find on the lattice is shown here. At large distances, it goes linearly with the distance between the two static color charges, and the coefficient here is the string tension. Now, the string tension should be given here in units of MeV square. However, what you see from this potential here is that sigma, the spring tension, has unit energy per length, which is a unit of force. Now, if you convert this to the more natural units, which we use in our everyday life, then this spring tension is about this big number in Newton. So it corresponds basically to a mass which has these 60 tons, which is huge. So it's really tremendous. And that certainly justifies why we call these strong interactions strong. Now, the other part here of the potential is the usual Coulomb potential. The coefficient here is the running coupling constant. And this running coupling constant can calculate the perturbation theory, which is shown here. If you go to smaller momenta, you have to do a non-perturbative calculation, and what you find that is a curve like this. It was calculated in an approach which I will discuss in my last lecture. So it saturates at low energies. Now, if we look at the quark masses which enter our QCD Lagrangian. These are the current quark masses, which are pretty small for the light quark flavors. However, in order to explain these baryon masses within the, or the hadron masses within the quark model, we need substantially larger masses, the so-called constituent masses. And they are about 300 eV for the up and down and about 500 for the stage quark. And the mechanism which produces from the small current masses the much larger constituent quark masses is spontaneous breaking of chiral symmetry. And this was nicely explained in Professor Kusarski's lecture, so I can be very brief. Let me just remind you about the mass Lagrangian. What I have shown here is the light quark flavors. Now, when you put all these masses equal, then we have the flavor symmetry, as Professor Pisarski explained in this lecture. And if you further put all the quark masses to zero, then you have this chiral symmetry. Chiral symmetry distinguishes basically from the flavor symmetry by putting the gamma 5 in the exponent of your flavor matrix. And if you express the gamma 5 in terms of the left and right projectors, then this U to the gamma 5 is given by the right projectors with the U and the left projectors with the inverse. So chiral symmetry means that the left and right-handed quarks transform oppositely, while in the case of flavor transformation, the left and right-handed quarks transform in the same way. This is basically the difference between chiral symmetry and flavor symmetry. Now, when you look at the various quark flavors, of course, the chiral symmetry makes no sense for the heavy quark flavors. But it's a very good approximation for the up and down quark, and can be used as a good starting point for when you need also the strange quark. This chiral symmetry is formed in QCD in three different ways. I mentioned already the explicit breaking by the current quark masses. Then there is the spontaneous breaking, which is the most important piece for me here during my talk. And then there is the anomalous breaking quantum effect, which was also discussed in Professor Pisarski lecture. Now, if you look at the consequences of the symmetry breaking, then what you find is when you ignore the quark masses, then you have just spontaneous breaking of chiral symmetry, your pseudoscalar mesons are Goldstone bosons, are exactly massless. And when you switch on the chiral anomaly, that is the violation of the chiral symmetry by quantum effects, then the eta 1 gets a big contribution of about 1 GeV. And now if you switch on also the current quark masses, then you have the pion gets massive, the kaon gets massive, and you have a mixing between the eta 1 and eta 8, and you end up with the eta prime and the eta. So these are the phenomenological consequences of chiral symmetry breaking. Now there is this other parameter for chiral symmetry breaking, which is the quark condensate. This is similar as the other parameter in the superconductor, where you have this electron pair condensation, and the other parameter is given here by the condensate of a pair of electrons. While this other parameter violates chiral invariance, this violates particle number conservation. And in fact, we will see later in my talk that the QCD vacuum resembles, in many respects, superconductor. The quark sector behaves very similar like an ordinary superconductor, and the gluon sector behaves in some respects like a so-called dual superconductor, which I will explain in a minute. Now, the quark condensate is here the order produced as order parameter for chiral symmetry breaking. So if you go to the phase diagram, this order parameter is non-zero in the hadronic phase and vanishes in the deconfined phase. We have also other parameters to describe the confinement phases, and the first other parameter which comes to mind is perhaps the temporal Wilson loop. Now, this quantity was also introduced in, I think, on Monday in John Paul's lecture. The Wilson loop is defined here by the line integral around the sketch field. Now, you can rewrite this quantity by introducing the current of a point charge moving along this loop C. And then you see that the exponent is nothing but the interaction term and the QCD diagram of the gauge field with an external current. So this Wilson loop basically measures the interaction of the gauge field with a current generated by point color charge. Now, you can consider various loops. In particular, you can consider so-called temporal Wilson loop, which you put in a plane with a time axis and one space axis. And then you can interpret this loop as the creation of a quark anti-quark pair at some time, let's say at some time zero, when the quark and the anti-quark evolve in time, and finally they are annihilated again. So this temporal Wilson loop describes the creation, the evolution, and the creation and annihilation, the creation and evolution and annihilation of a quark pair. So then it's not surprising that when you calculate the expectation value of this quantity, you get the potential between the quark and the anti-quark as the coefficient of the time interval over which you consider this temporal loop. Now, we have seen previously in the confined regime, we have these, for large distances, this linearizing potential, which goes with the distance, with the coefficient given by the spring tension. If you plug this in, you find the so-called area law, because R times D is the area of this loop, and the coefficient is this Wilson spring tension. Now, what you can also show is that in the deconfined phase, you don't have this linearizing potential. Instead, what you get here for your Wilson loop is a parameter law. So you can not only consider these temporal loops, you can also consider spatial Wilson loop, which you put, in, for example, in a plane where both axes are spatial axes. And the spatial Wilson loop behaves differently from the temporal Wilson loop if you go to finite temperatures. So let me also discuss it briefly. I mean, I skip here the path ordering for the moment. Let me ignore the path ordering. And what you can do, you can rewrite this loop integral into a surface integral, and then you have here the magnetic field for which you integrate. So what you see, the spatial Wilson loop basically measures the magnetic flux, this loop. Of course, if you are at zero temperatures, by the O4 invariance of your theory, the spatial and temporal Wilson loop behave in the same way. So you can also use the spatial Wilson loop at zero temperature. Now, there's another other parameter which we use for confinement. This is the Polyakov loop, which we have heard about this morning. Professor Pisarsky talk. So let me just briefly discuss this loop as well to make clear the connection to the Wilson loop. Now the point is, if you go to finite temperatures, then your partition function can be expressed as this function integral with the Euclidean action, and you have periodic boundary conditions to your fields. Now, the periodic boundary conditions basically compactify your time axis to a circle, and the length of the circle represents the inverse temperature which enters here in the partition function. Now, assume you consider a T temporal Wilms loop in Euclidean space which extends over the whole time axis. Now, due to the conductification, you have also identified these two ends of the Wilms loop, and you have one line going in this direction, the other in this direction, which at least in QED cancel exactly. And then you are left with two loops running around the compactified time axis. And these are just Polyakov loops. There is a Polyakov loop and its complex conjugate because it runs in the opposite direction. And since you have this connection between the Polyakov, between the Wilson loop and these two Polyakov loops, it's not surprising that the expectation value of this two Polyakov loops also gives you the quark anti-quark potential. And if I have time, I will come back to this relation in my exercises and we'll discuss it in more detail. So the Polyakov, instead of taking the Polyakov loop correlator, you can also take the Polyakov loop itself. It represents basically the excess of the free energy of an isolated quark over the vacuum. And for confined systems, we have no isolated quarks. This free energy goes to infinity and the Polyakov loop vanishes. In the deconfined phase, this free energy is finite and the Polyakov loop is non-zero. We have seen this morning how this Polyakov loop behaves as a function of the temperature. And I will later calculate this quantity as well. Now, when we ask what is the symmetry between this deconfinement phase transition and this is the so-called center symmetry, which Fasok also explained this morning, I will come back to the symmetry in connection with the center vortices in my second lecture. So we have now in the phase diagram these two order parameters. In the confined phase we have the quark condensate is non-zero and the Polyakov loop vanishes. In the deconfined phase the Polyakov loop is non-zero but the quark condensate vanishes. So there is yet another order law, precisely this order parameter, which is the Tuff loop, the spatial Tuff loop, more precisely. It was somehow hidden this morning in lecture, but we did not really explicitly discuss it. I will later come back to this loop and I will give you the precise definition when I calculate it. This will be, I guess, in my last lecture. And yet another, sorry, there is something missing here. Okay, yeah, for the moment, let me just tell you why the spatial wind loop measures the magnetic flux, the spatial Tuff loop measures the electric flux. So it has a very clear physical meaning. There is yet another other parameter which I'm going to use, which is the dual quark condensate, or sometimes called the Kress-Polyakov loop, because it's in fact something like the Kress-Polyakov loop. I will give the definition of this order parameter also when I calculate it. So, I'm now here. I gave you this introduction, the basic properties of QCD, which I need later. And now I come to describe this magnetic monopole picture of the QCD vacuum. Now, I will confine myself into a qualitative explanation because I will later give a more detailed explanation of the center vortex picture and the monopoles are somehow tied to the center vortex picture and we will see that the center vortex picture somehow also implies that the monopoles are part of the game. Now, if you have a normal material and you bring it into a magnetic field, the field lines are somewhat disturbed, but in principle the magnetic field can go through the material. Now this is different in a superconductor. If you have a type 1 superconductor, again you have here the magnetic field lines and you have the type 1 superconductor, then the field lines cannot enter or penetrate the superconductor. They go around the superconductor, and we know there are London currents at the surface which prevent the magnetic field from entering this superconducting material. Now, when you have a so-called type 2 superconductor, The magnetic field lines can penetrate the superconductor in forms of flux lines, or small flux tubes. And in these flux lines, the superconducting phase is locally destroyed. And you get basically inside these flux tubes, you have basically the normal conducting phase. Now, when you have such a type 2 superconductor, and you would insert magnetic monopoles into this type 2 superconductor, let's say a magnetic monopole and a mental monopole, what will happen is that the field lines
will not spread out
like in, according to Coulomb's law, but they will be squeezed into flux tubes. You get the flux tube which you expect from the field lines between static quarks and QCD. Now the QCD vacuum is considered to be a so-called dual superconductor, where dual means that the electric and magnetic field is exchanged, or the electric and magnetic charges is exchanged. So while the ordinary superconductor consists of a condensation of electron pairs, the dual superconductor would consist of a condensation of magnetic monopoles. Now in the dual superconductor, if you insert electric charges, here electric color charges, then their field lines will also be squeezed into flux tubes, and you obtain the finding picture, the confining picture which you have in mind, which we know that should be there then logically. So I mean this dual Meissner effect, this dual superconductor, gives a nice picture of how the flux tube is formed and how charges can be confined in QCD. This was the picture which was suggested by Mandelstam and Tuft. And I will come now, so what, when we compare this superconductor again, these flux tubes give rise to the linear potential. This I think is quite known.
I have a question.
Yeah?
What happens if I put a magnetic monopole into the first type superconductor?
That's a good question. I mean, you should have, should get, if you want to bring it in, it should pick up infinite energy basically. Yeah. Should be impossible basically. I mean, unless you.
Right.
I mean, in that case, I think you would need an infinite energy really to bring it into the material. Thank you. So now, this picture has been confirmed by lattice calculations. And this was done in the following way. You go to the so-called maximum Abelian gauge. These Abelian gauges were suggested by Tuft when he suggested this dual Meissner picture. And the story is the following. Consider, for example, SU2. In SU2, you have an Abelian subgroup U1. What remains then, if you take out this Abelian subgroup, is the so-called coset. Now, you have three generators of this group. One generator corresponding to this U1 group. Now the corresponding gauge field is considered as abelian because you have an abelian group, and it has no charge of which is related to this abelian subgroup. While these other two generators corresponding to this coset, they carry the charge related to this abelian subgroup. Now what you do in the so-called maximum Abelian gauge is you take the sum of two, of the square of the two non-Abelian gauge field, and you minimize the sum. This is a gauge condition. This you can, I mean you can work with also the continuum, but usually you do it on the lattice. And once you have implemented this gauge, you do a so-called Abelian projection. You put the non-Abelian gauge fields to zero by hand. And then you calculate from the remaining Abelian gauge field, for example, the spring tension. And what you find then is that the spring tension which you find, which I denote here by the Abelian projection, is about 95% of the full Wilson spring tension. And this was taken as support for this dual Meissner picture of the QCD vacuum. Now, what I will show in the exercises is that when you go to this gauge and you do the abelian projection, you get magnetic monopoles here in this abelian gauge field. Now, what you can do with that is you can calculate the Wilson string tension for just the monopole content of this abelian gauge field. So you keep only contribution from configuration with monopoles, and then you still obtain about 90% of the string tension. Now, these latest calculations were initiated by Schierholz and Wiese in the first paper. Was Kronenfeld, Schierholz, Wiese, and somebody else, which I don't remember. Now, when these people saw that this picture seems to work on the lattice, other groups also jumped into the subject. This is the Japanese group with Professor Suzuki, then at ITEP, Polikarpov and collaborators, and then also in Berlin, Müller-Preusker and Fritz. Basically, these people collaborated. So, the lattice seems to indicate that, yeah.
So, what's the difference of this monopole compared to textbooks of polyagraph monopole?
I will show in the exercise that this monopole is, which you get here after a mini projection, looks precisely like an ordinary magnetic monopole which you find in textbooks. But the point is, I mean, I will explain how this monopole arises. I mean, it's a little bit algebra, and this I will do during the exercises. So if you can wait till this afternoon, I will explain how the monopole emerges in these abelian gauges. What's also interesting is that the charge of the monopole is quantized topologically. It is related to the winding number of this so-called second homotopy group. The point is, the coset of SU2 is equivalent to an S2, and now this S2 can map on the surface surrounding this monopole. And these mappings can be according to these homotopy groups, and the winding number of this homotopy group gives the magnetic monopole charge. So one has then criticized, as usual, that this is a gauge-dependent procedure. There are no real magnetic monopoles in QCD in the sense that you can find, for example, classical solutions like instantons, and then can use these instantons to calculate, for example, the spring tension. By the way, when you calculate the spring tension from the instantons, you get only 10%. So instantons definitely are not responsible for confinement. At the beginning, one thought instantons might be also responsible for confinement. There are these instanton liquid models where you have some parameters and with sufficient interaction can always get climate symmetry breaking. But confinement is a different story, and instantons definitely cannot give you confinement. I think this is clear for now. So now the coming to your question, the point is the following. When you do this gauge transformation into the maximum abelian gauge. We have some gauge transformation, which I call here B, which is defined here on the coset SU2 over U1. Then, from this, I mean, when you do the gauge transformation, you get also this inhomogeneous term from the gauge transformation. And now if you take this term and you keep the abelian or take the abelian part, just A3, and calculate the magnetic field from that, what you find is precisely a Dirac monopole with a Dirac string. But you know in QCD you have a non-abelian gauge field strength, and the field strength contains also this quadratic term, which you can write as A cross A. Now if you take, calculate this term, as I will do in the exercise this afternoon, and you find a magnetic monopole with the opposite sign, opposite charge, but without the Dirac string. And now in the full field strings, you have to add up these two terms, you find just the Dirac string. And the Dirac string, of course, is unobservable. And this should be the case, because this is a pure gauge. It should not have a non-Hamiltonian field strength.
But this is all consistent.
And what is crucial to find these monopoles, you need to do this Abelian projection. It takes the Abelian part here, calculates the magnetic field, and you find an ordinary Dirac monopole. So I mean, these monopoles are certainly tied to Abelian projection and to this gauge. But nevertheless, we will see in this afternoon in my exercises that also the monopoles are gauge artifacts, artifacts of the Abelian projection. They are topological obstructions which are gauge invariant and which causes also the emergence of the monopoles. So the reason why we see monopoles in this gauge is a gauge invariant, basically a feature of QCD. So it's not as bad as one might think. So there have been so-called dual superconductor models of QCD, which basically are Ginzburg-Langer type of series, however with a dual gauge field, and the quartz anti-quartz in the series are not point charges but are magnetic monopoles in this dual theory. This has been worked out, I mean, people have worked on this subject for many years. I quoted here two people, but there are many more who worked on that. This was for quite some time successful. But we will see that this monopole picture somehow is in a way also triggered by the vortex condensation picture that I'm going to discuss now. Are there questions so far?
Yeah. So how does the ghost come into this?
The ghost here, at the moment there's no ghost at all.
But we fix the gauge.
I fix the gauge, right, that's correct. Yeah, the ghost, I could look at the Fadeyev-Popov determinant. And basically what happens is the monopoles are sitting on the Kirchhoff horizon. Okay. But this is at the moment not important, but it's an important question. I will come actually back to this point in my last lecture when I discuss the Hamiltonian gauge in Coulomb gate, then we will also find again the monopoles on the Kirchhoff horizon.
So,
this so far was the magnetic monopole picture. I come now to the second talk, second subject, to the center vortex picture. How much time do I have to do?
20 minutes.
20 minutes, okay, thanks. So, these are vortices which you all know in the fluid. You have certainly observed vortices in water, for example, in the bath tube or somewhere else. This is from the ocean. So, what are vortices? In the fluid, you have a velocity field, and by taking the curl of the velocity field, you define the vorticity, you get the vorticity. Now in the gauge field, the equivalent of the velocity field is the gauge potential, and the equivalent of vorticity is the magnetic field. You can calculate the circulation by taking this line integral of the velocity field, which is here the line integral of the gauge potential, and you know by Stokes' theorem that this basically measures here in the case of the gauge field the magnetic flux, and here it measures the vorticity through a certain area. Now when you have a point particle in this vortex, this moving velocity field, you have the Magnus force and the equivalence in the gauge field, or QED here, is the Lorentz force. So there's really a one-to-one correspondence. Now, these vortices, as you have seen on the previous picture, maybe on this picture here, they basically are point light. I mean, you have, when you have what is on the surface, and water, this is the surface of water, these vortices, appear as point singularities here, the core of the vortex. So the vortex are basically point-like here in two dimensions. When you go to higher dimensions, in three dimensions, these vortices move out in the third direction and they become line type of singularities. And in four dimensions, when you evolve these loops in the fourth dimension, they become surfaces. Now the vortices which you have in QCD, they are closed
surfaces.
They can self-interact, they can have any kind of complicated topology, and they are also non-oriented. And we'll later see they have to be non-oriented in order to explain chiral symmetry breaking. So as the name says already, center vortices must be related to the center of the gauge group. We have heard about the center already this morning. Let me summarize here some features which I need. The center of the gauge group consists of all elements which compute with all other elements of the gauge group. Now there are groups which have a trivial center, like for example the G2, or there are also groups like the Abelian group U1, where the whole group is the center. Now we are interested here in the center of SQN gauge groups. Now for SQ2, the center elements are the unit matrix, 2x2 unit matrix, and the minus unit matrix. These are the only center elements. So the center of the SU2 group is the Z2 and consists of these two elements. Now, in the case of SUN, the center is defined by this n square root, the unit circle, which we have seen this morning. They are given by these faces, and they are n center elements. There is always the trivial center element, which is the unit matrix, and then there are n minus non-trivial center elements, which contain here non-trivial faces. Now, we need also later SU3, because the group of QCD, and there we have three non-trivial center elements, the trivial, one trivial and two non-trivial center elements. I will at the beginning stick to the SU2 group because there the center is quite trivial, and later on I will then consider also the SU3 group. Now, what is the center vortex in the gauge theory? Well, you can define the center vortex by its property, which is asked that you consider a Wilson loop of such an object. Now consider the Wilson loop which I have introduced before. Now a center vortex field is a gauge field which is localized on some closed loop in three dimensions. And when you go with the Wilson loop around this vortex loop, then you pick up a center element, a non-trivial center element. In fact, if the loop from the vortex and the loop from the Wilson loop are linked in a non-trivial way. So the quantity here in the exponent is the Gaussian leaking number. This is a topological object. So these Wilson loops are defined in some center vortices, are defined by these topological properties and do not depend on the details of the shape of the center vortex or the shape of the Wilson loop. So the important thing is that each of these center vortices is characterized by a non-trivial center element. So for SU2 we have only one kind of center vortices which are related to this non-trivial center element. Z is equal to the negative unit matrix. For SU3 we have two different kinds of center vortices. Questions? Yeah.
Is it obvious that the center vortex always close as we draw?
Yeah, they close always.
Okay, so that it's such a normal.
It is a normal. So for SV2 we have this two, I told you so that this two, the one non-trivial center element, there's only one kind of center vortices. Now, one can now show by lattice calculations, and I will show you results later on, that in the ensemble of field configuration which you sum up in the functional integral, the center vortices are the infinite dominant field configurations. And I will show you later on that they are responsible both for confinement and also for spontaneous breaking of chiral symmetry. And let me already show you one result before I explain how these lattice calculations are done and how you show this vortex dominance on the lattice. Let me show you the following result. What is shown here is the static warp potential in QCD. The red line here is the full lattice calculation, just ordinary SQ2 lattice gauge theory. And now what you can do on the lattice, you can remove all center vortex field configurations. So from the ensemble of field configurations which you sum over in the functional integral, you throw away all those configurations which contain center vortices. And what you find, then is this flat curve. You still get the Coulomb potential, but the linearizing confinement potential is gone. So removing the center vortices, you lose definitely this confining part of the potential. Now what you can also do on the lattice, and I will explain this later how this is done, you can keep from all field configurations which you have in your functional integral, only those field configurations which do contain center vortices. And what you find then is this green curve. You find only the linearizing, the confining part of the potential, and you miss the Coulomb part.
Could you still explain the difference between red and this green line? I mean, this red and green points?
No, these are various, you see here, these are these various industrial. But this is at the moment not important. At the moment, what is important is that when you remove center vortices, the potential becomes flat, you lose the confining part. On the other hand, if you keep only center vortex configuration, you get only the confining part and you lose the Coulomb part. That is the physics. Okay. So now, to do this calculation, we need the lattice. We had an excellent introduction to lattice gauge theory, Professor Kaczmarek, during this school, so I can be very brief. As he explained, that the gauge field lives on links. You have here these link variables, which you basically are given by the exponent of the continuum field times the lattice spacing, at least you can present it that way. And then you have to do the functional integral by summing over, integrating over all these link variables. And this you do with some Monte Carlo technique, whatever heat pass or whatever you prefer. So he also explained that you have a lattice action, which is this Wilson action, this Blanquette action, which is all not important at the moment. So now when you calculate the Wilson line, it is very easy on the lattice. You have principally to calculate this path ordered line integral. So that is what you do, you just multiply the links, the group elements corresponding to these link variables, so this U's. In particular, if you have a Wilson group, you have just to multiply all these links around this closed group. So I mean, this path ordering is no problem on the lattice. Of course, it's not so in the continuum. Continuum path ordering is a problem. Technically, yeah, it's difficult. So now, how are the center vortices defined on the lattice? I mentioned already we need a certain gauge. And the gauge which we need here is the so-called maximum center gauge. So what is this gauge? Consider a link variable for SU2. And I use the so-called S4 parameterization. So I use four real parameters. This alpha vector contains three real parameters. Alpha naught is also a real parameter, and in order that this element here is an element of the SU2 group, these parameters have to fulfill this S formulation, which defines the Hilbert sphere in four dimensions. So this is a constraint to this variable. So in principle, there are only three variables independent. Now, in the maximal center gauge, what you are doing, you go into such, or you do a gauge transformation such that you bring these links as close as possible to a center element. So if you have, let's say, a link variable with a positive alpha naught, you try to maximize alpha such that it comes close to 1. Or if it's here in the negative regime, you also maximize the module so that alpha becomes as close as possible to minus 1. So the idea is you bring the link, each link variable, as close as possible to the center element of to the nearest center element of the gauge group, which is here for SU2 either plus 1 or minus 1. Now that is formulated in this way here. You take the trace and the module of the links and maximize this functional. Now the question, what does this gauge mean in the continuum?
It's not an easy question to answer.
I mean, we have worked out to know what it is, but I mean, it's by far more trivial what it is. So, what you are doing, you implement this maximum center gauge using the gauge degree of freedom to bring each link variable as close as possible to the center elements. And then once you have implemented this gauge, you do the center projection, which means you put this part here, this non-abelian part, to zero and keep only this alpha naught part. That means you replace each link by its nearest center element. So after the center projection, you are left basically with Z2 gauge field configurations. Now, what you get then is something which I've illustrated here first in two dimensions. You get some line of non-trivial center elements, or links which are given by non-trivial center elements, which are shown here in purple. And all the other links, which I did not show, are equal to the trivial center element. Now, if you have such a line of non-trivial center elements, it is not difficult to see that at the end of this line of non-trivial center elements, you have a center vortex. What you see when you calculate the plaquettes, you have to multiply all the links. These three links are 1. This link is minus 1. You get minus 1. So if you have put your Wilson loop here around, you get minus 1. You get a non-trivial center element. So this defines the center vortex. On the other hand, if you have here this plaquette, you get plus 1 times minus 1 gives plus 1. You have a trivial Wilson loop. The Wilson loop is 1. Same as if there were no gauge field at all. Now the same thing works in higher dimension. In three dimension, you get surfaces of non-trivial center elements, and the boundary of the surfaces was formed by plaquettes, which are all minus 1. This non-trivial center element, and they form the surface. So you see, the vortex itself lives on the dual lattice, not on the lattice itself. Okay. Now, in four dimensions, you have volumes of non-trivial center elements, and the vortices are given by the surfaces. So we have closed surfaces, and they are closed here by Bianchi identity. You see it already here in three dimensions that these loops have to be closed, these vortex loops. They cannot be open. Okay? So, this was mentioned before. So to calculate the Wilson loop, so I have illustrated here. Take any Wilson loop which is pierced here by this vortex and you get minus 1. You get the non-trivial center element. The same here as you see. So the Wilson loop basically is the center vortex counter. It measures how many vortices pierce the loop. So, what center projection basically does is the following, physically speaking. You have originally in your gauge field configuration some center vortex, which is the smooth configuration, which has the property that if you go with the wheels loop around, you pick up a non-trivial center element. And then in the procedure of maximal center gauge fixing and center projection, you replace this thick center vortex by a thin one, which leaves you on these individual plaquettes. You can also measure on the lattice the thickness of these center vortices, and what you find is that they have a thickness and diameter of about 0.8 Fermi. So they are quite fat, they are not really small. And this, how this can be measured is a different story, I don't explain here. Now, this is a picture I showed before. You do the center projection, go to the maximum center gauge, replace them all in by its closest center element, and then you calculate from the center projected gauge configuration the Wilson loop, and then you find here this green curve. Now, how do you remove center vortices? And you find that the string tensor is basically the same one as in the full gauge theory. The method of removing center, I should mention, which I have not mentioned, was that this center projection was invented by these people here, the William Faber, Kinzel, and the Vedic. Now, to remove center vortices is a method which goes back to the Fokran and the Lia. You do a center projection, you replace each link by its nearest center element. Now, what we are doing now, you multiply a given link by this center projected link. And what you do then is that you add to a physical vortex a thin vortex.
Now, if you have two vortices on top of each other, it's the same as having
no vortex. Because you get the minus one twice, minus one square gives the plus one. Remember, these. This loop was the center vortex counter, and then you have removed the center vortices. And this is the technique you use to calculate then the potential with center vortices removed, and then you find this flat curve. That's a spring tension score. Now, when you take a gauge field configuration, this is here from the Adelaide group. They like to visualize this field configuration with the color of the zone, the action density. And then you do the center projection. What you find is shown here, what you find is shown here on the right hand side. This is the three dimensional volume of our four dimensional lattice universe. So you have basically kept one coordinate fixed. And then you find after center projection this kind of vortex structure.
And you can show that this
vortices calculate. Basically what you can do, you can go from one point of the universe to the other point just going along center vortices. So how much time do you have?
1 minute.
1 minute. Maybe then I should stop here because I have a little bit more time to explain how the center vortex picture explains confinement. You will see that the area comes out quite naturally from the center vortex picture. That's a good question. I can't answer. I mean, you can calculate propagators, and you can see whether the propagator has the property. Mm-hmm. In what we did is the gluon propagator, and then we saw that the property basically is there. But I can't give you a general proof of that or general statement. But that's an important question. Yeah.
When you are calculating the potential at finite temperature, then of course. This confined part is disappearing, and actually you are going to this kind of Coulomb part, which is constant. So that means that these thermal excitations are presumably killing this center vortices in the configuration. That's why you are do not seeing this confined part.
Now look, this calculation I showed you before, I have zero time control.
I know, but I'm thinking right. in
I will explain in my second part, my talk, what will happen with these vortices at finite temperature. They are still there, but they align along the time axis. If it's just a nice, good question, but I mean, we will see that these vortices explain not only the emergence of the area law, the confinement, and also the deconfinement phase transition, gets a natural explanation here in this vortex picture.
Okay, thank you. I have a somewhat related question. These vortices form loops, right?
Yeah.
It's three. Are these loops entangled or are they independent?
They are very complicated. I mean, they are complicated numbers which are non-zero and so on. I mean, they're calculated actually. So I will show later. I mean, this.
Okay, you will
tell me. I mean, this vortex metal is really a very complicated subject, very complicated material.
But do you have any measure of the entanglement of this
system of loops? Not really.
Now, we don't have time for further discussion at this point, so we have to postpone. But more questions to the exercise sessions. Now, one announcement. Somebody has lost their backpacks or left their backpacks in the bowling alley last night. So if anyone of you realize